Remember, electricity is dangerous. You should always be properly trained and qualified before working on any electrical equipment. If you're working with electrical control systems, here's something you should know. It's not always the big things that fail. It's the little mistakes that nobody warns you about. In this video, we'll go through 7 critical errors that are overlooked and how to avoid them. So, let's get started. Mistake number 1. Using a contactor for low voltage DC. I've seen this issue in control panels far too often, even in well-built systems. In some designs, 5 to 12 volts DC from an electronic card is routed through a contactor and then into a PLC or another device. The problem is, contactors aren't built for low voltage DC. Even though they're enclosed, they're not sealed, so over time, dust and oxidation accumulate on the contacts. With such small DC currents, it doesn't take long before the signal can't pass through reliably, leading to control failure. The proper fix is to use a bifurcated relay. These are designed specifically for low-level signals. They're sealed units with dual wiping contacts that make multiple contact points and scrape through any oxidation. This gives you a reliable, clean path, even at just a few volts. Mistake number 2, daisy-chaining interlock or e-stop devices in the field. The real issue with daisy-chaining interlocks and e-stops in the field is troubleshooting. Since only one hot wire goes out to the devices and a single return comes back to the panel, either to a PLC or a relay, any failure breaks the entire chain. That means you have to troubleshoot every device in the field instead of isolating the problem from the control panel, and that can lead to hours of downtime. The correct way to wire these systems is to bring 2 wires from each switch back to the control panel. Then, if you need to daisy chain, do it at the terminal blocks inside the panel. That way, if there's a problem with any switch, all the troubleshooting can be done right at the control panel, not out in the field. Mistake number 3, not grounding the neutral to the panel. I've seen this mistake more than once, where the neutral on the secondary side of a control transformer isn't bonded to the panel and to the incoming ground. This creates both a safety hazard and a troubleshooting nightmare. Here's the issue. If the hot side of the control voltage shorts to the panel and the neutral isn't grounded, the control power fuse won't blow and the panel chassis can stay energized. That means the entire enclosure becomes dangerously live without anyone realizing it. In a properly designed control panel, the transformer's secondary neutral is bonded both to the panel chassis and to the incoming ground. This ensures that any fault has a clear return path, so the fuse blows immediately, preventing shock hazards and fire risk. Mistake number 4, placing the input devices on the neutral side in relay logic circuits. This mistake often happens when someone modifies a control circuit. In this example, line 3 shows relay 2 connected to the hot side, while the input limit switch is placed on the neutral side. Even though the circuit works, this is not good practice. According to the NEC, National Electrical Code, and IEC standards, control devices like push buttons and limit switches must interrupt the hot line side, not the neutral. Always ensure that output devices, like relays and motors, are connected to the neutral side of the circuit, while input devices, such as limit switches, proximity sensors, and push buttons, are placed on the line or the hot side. Mistake number 5, too many branches from one input switch. Take a look at this schematic. The limit switch LS1 feeds 3 branches through wire 21, each controlling a load, solenoid 1, solenoid 2, and relay 2. The issue here is that all the current flows through LS1, including inrush currents from these inductive loads. LS1 is a mechanical switch, not designed for high combined current, and over time, this can damage its contacts. Also, running multiple branches from a single switch may work, but it's not good practice. A better design is to have limit switch LS1 energize a 3 PDT relay, labeled R1. Each of R1's 3 normally open contacts can then control solenoid 1, solenoid 2, and relay 2 individually. This approach keeps the schematic clean and organized. More importantly, LS1 no longer carries the combined current of all 3 loads, only the small coil current needed to energize R1. Mistake number 6, not isolating PLC outputs from high-power inductive loads. This is usually a design issue, and it often comes down to cutting costs. PLC output cards use electronic components like transistors to switch loads. Some may have relay outputs, but those relays are small and not built to handle high currents. Inductive loads, like motor starters, contactors, and large solenoids, create high inrush currents and voltage spikes during switching. For example, a contactor coil rated at just 0.5 amps can pull up to 5 amps during inrush. These spikes can slowly damage the PLC output card, leading to failure over time. A more reliable control panel design is to have the PLC output energize an interposing relay rather than powering high-load devices directly. These relays have small coils with low current draw and minimal inrush, making them much easier on the PLC's output card. Then, use the relay contacts to switch larger loads, like contactors, motor starters, or solenoid valves. This not only extends the life of your PLC outputs, but also adds a layer of electrical isolation. And here's an important best practice. Always fuse the PLC output that powers the relay coil. If the coil ever shorts out, a properly sized fast blow fuse will trip instantly, protecting your PLC output. Mistake number 7, not using surge suppressors on output coils. Even after isolating the PLC outputs using relays to drive contactors, motor starters, or solenoids, voltage spikes can still occur, especially when switching inductive loads. These spikes may not return through the PLC output, but they can propagate through the control panel's power and ground lines, potentially disrupting or damaging the PLC CPU, input cards, and other sensitive electronics. There are two effective ways to protect your control system from voltage spikes caused by inductive loads. First, install surge suppressors, such as snubber circuits or MOVs in parallel with each coil. These components absorb the energy released when the coil de-energizes, preventing it from damaging other parts of the system. Second, install a surge suppressor in the main control circuit, right after the control transformer. This provides system-wide protection. If the suppressor fails and shorts, the control fuse will blow, isolating the fault safely. Good electrical control design isn't just about making things work. It's about safety, serviceability, and long-term reliability. Avoiding these 7 mistakes sets you up for better performance and fewer headaches. If you found this helpful, hit subscribe, and I'll see you in the next video.